O-K-I.
Before we get started with part 4, let's quickly go over the Vedrine's family tree, and then a timeline of events thus far. At the top, we have the matriarch, Guillemette de Vedrine. Her three children are Charles-Henri de Vedrine, who's married to Christine de Vedrine, Ghislaine de Vedrine, who's married to Jean Marchand, Philippe de Vedrine, whose partner is Brigitte Martine. The children of Charles-Henri and Christine are Guillaume, Amory, and Diane. The children of Ghislaine and Jean Marchand are Francois and Guillemette. Guillemette was married to Sebastian in September of 2001, but divorced him only 4 months later, in January of 2002. Okay, now here's a quick recap of what's been covered thus far. In 1997, Tilly met Ghislaine. He spent 3 years ingratiating himself with her, before she introduced him to the rest of the family in August of 2000. From 2000 until 2001, he proved himself to the family by helping them with their problems and became something like their personal savior. From 2001 until 2003, under his influence, they became afraid to leave their house. He destroyed their businesses, marriages, and lives. He managed to do this even though he left France and moved to England in 2001 in order to escape charges for fraudulent bankruptcy. Once in England, he continued to manipulate the family by phone and email. Links to the family tree and the timeline of events can be found in the description box below. Okay, with that out of the way, let's get started with part 4. By this stage in the story, 2003 was coming to a close. By the end of 2003, all of their children were separated from them by Tilly. Francois and Amory were sent to Oxford, under the guise that it was for their studies, and Diane was enrolled into a boarding school. Instead of continuing their education, Francois and Amory were left stationed in a two-room apartment for months, with nothing to do. Money was sent to pay for Francois and Amory's tuition, but Tilly pocketed all of it. When Tilly visited the boys, he gaslighted them into believing that their parents had abandoned them. He said that their parents never called because they didn't love them anymore, and that they were even capable of poisoning them. Being a skilled manipulator, Tilly knew he had to keep them occupied as to not give them time to discuss and critically think. Therefore, he made up nonsense for them to do. Tilly told them to watch a building which he said the Blue Light Foundation planned to make into its headquarters. Every day from 7 a.m. until 6 p.m, they sat in a cafe, surveying the building and taking notes of any suspicious activity. Tilly also assigned them the task of buying cell phones of specific make, model, and color for Jacques Gonzalez. After Gonzalez was arrested in 2009, police found the very same collection of cell phones stashed away in his home, many of them still in their packaging. One day, Francois' sister, Guillemette, joined the boys in England. They all lived in a crowded apartment without much to do, so things quickly became contentious. The apartment didn't have any heating or hot water, and they were all penniless. As a result, the relationships began to deteriorate, and Amory asked Tilly to let him move out and live alone, away from his two cousins, Francois and Guillemette. Eventually, Tilly moved Amory into an office which he claimed belonged to the Blue Light Foundation, with the conditions that no one could know that he lived there, and that he must undergo some self-examination in order to reflect on why he was unable to get along with his cousins. The office, of course, did not belong to Tilly, so Amory squatted there illegally. He slept in a sleeping bag and washed himself with cold water from a sink. His cousins would visit to bring him one meal a day. For 9 months, Amory never left the office. Tilly gave him some books as well as a notepad for him to record his thoughts and the progress of his self-examination, which Tilly called a necessary exercise if he was to succeed in becoming himself. Tilly told Amory that he would share the notebook with a psychologist to help him. One morning, a bailiff knocked on the door and told Amory that he was trespassing. He informed him that the rent for the office hadn't been paid in months. Afterwards, Amory moved back in with his cousins, who, under the influence of Tilly, berated him for losing a perfectly good apartment through sheer stupidity. After moving back in with his cousins, Francois and Guillemette, he was forbidden from entering the apartment any further than the entrance hall. Later, Tilly ordered Amory, Francois, and Guillemette to take jobs in England at places like Zara and Burger King. Additionally, in order to fund the fight against their enemies, they gave 90% of their earnings to him. Meanwhile, the adults in the family almost never left Philippe's house, and for 18 months they weren't allowed to see their children. They were only told about them indirectly while sending money, but most often any news they heard would be about how Tilly's men had successfully thwarted another attempt on their children's lives. By August 2006, Christine and Charles Henry were invited to Oxford by Tilly to discuss the progress of their investments. Although he told them that they would stay there for only 3 or 4 days, their stay instead lasted until 2009. Before their journey to England, Christine sifted through the state of their finances and calculated that by that point, they had lost around 4.5 million euros since entrusting their finances to Tilly. It had been 6 years since Christine had first met Thierry Tilly, but she felt as though she hardly knew the man. Before traveling to England, she had only seen him 3 times, spoke to him once on the telephone, and a few times via email. When she and her husband, Charles Henry, met him in Oxford, he set them up in a dilapidated little house opposite of his. It was still undergoing renovations, and electrical wires hung from the ceiling. Several of its rooms were barely habitable, and the kitchen was unfinished. Tilly apologized several times for his lackluster accommodation, but promised them that once the house was finished, it would belong to their son Guillaume. In her book, Christine writes, quote, "Tilly spends most of his time up in the attic, in his office, except when he disappears for the whole afternoon. He has long discussions with Charles Henry, who becomes evasive when I ask him what they talk about." After 2 weeks in England, Christine finally broached the topic of money with Tilly. Tilly then took her aside and sat her down to tell her about his plan. He explained to her that somewhere locked inside of her was knowledge of a secret hidden treasure. He told her, like Charles Henry, she was a descendant of a very old family. He said that there were ancient families in France who were the chosen guardians of treasure, entrusted to them over the centuries by kings, so that they may come to the aid of the most impoverished and guarantee equilibrium. He then said that these families passed on the secret from generation to generation. The secret he was referring to was called the transmission. He said that her family possessed considerable hidden riches, which she had knowledge of locked away inside of her memory, but the location of the treasure and how to retrieve it needed to be unlocked. Christine, he said, must find the treasure, which consisted of gold and jewels. After hearing this, Christine reacted logically, calling his story absurd. Unlike most members of the family, Christine says that she had many doubts about Thierry Tilly from the get-go, but she claims that she went along with his orders out of fear of being alienated by the rest of the family. Tilly continued his story, telling her that he knew for a fact that the transmission was real because his boss, Jacques Gonzalez, witnessed it. He added that the immense burden of the transmission was too heavy for her and that she must have lost all memory of it. According to him, this sometimes happened, and his boss had already seen several cases like it. He explained that the more serious the matter, the more easily it slips the mind. Throughout the following days, Charles Henry begged his wife Christine to do all that she could to unlock the transmission and to save the family. When she argued that she had no memory of it, Charles Henry became annoyed. One day, Tilly sent Charles Henry and Guillaume to deliver laptops to Jacques Gonzalez. They drove to a cafe where they met with a tall, thin man named Pascal the Great. Then they gave Pascal the keys to their car with the laptop still inside and waited several hours before he reappeared and returned the car to them before leaving once again. Upon their return to Oxford, Tilly instructed Charles Henry to tell Christine that during his trip to England, he saw proof that the transmission was real and that the hidden treasure exists. And Charles Henry did just that. Charles Henry told Christine that he visited the offices of the Blue Light Foundation and was shown reliable documents which proved beyond any doubt that the transmission and the treasure were both real. Meanwhile, Tilly continued to question Christine, explaining that he believed the whereabouts of the treasure was locked somewhere inside of her subconscious. After several days of interrogation, Christine told him that she once attended a ball in which young girls were formally introduced into Belgian high society. For some reason, Tilly latched onto this anecdote and used it to conclude that it meant that the treasure was somewhere in Belgium. In no time, he sent Christine, escorted by her son Guillaume, to Belgium and instructed them to visit banks to see if Christine had accounts in any of them. Over the course of a week, Christine and Guillaume went from bank to bank and were repeatedly told by confused tellers that there were no accounts or safety deposit boxes under her name. Although the futility of this quest must have been clear to her, Christine felt as though she had failed her family. When she and her son returned to England, she broke down and said to Tilly, quote, "Thierry, am I still one of the 11? I don't want to be thought of as a traitor. I've done nothing wrong." Later, her worries were justified. Her family began to treat her badly, believing that she was withholding the location of the treasure out of greed. Her husband, Charles Henry, felt as though she was betraying the family and putting their children's lives at risk. Tilly screamed at her, blaming her for impoverishing them all by refusing to say where the treasure was. After that, her imprisonment began. Tilly said it would last until she could reveal the location of the transmission. Tilly confiscated her ID, watch, engagement ring, and necklace, claiming that they were all bugged, an explanation meant to conceal his real intention to pawn them. Although Tilly must have known that the transmission did not exist, he reacted with explosive anger whenever Christine failed to tell him where it was. Years later, when the family wasn't under his influence anymore, they speculated that his whole talk of the transmission and the hidden treasure had just been a ploy to see if they were hiding money from him in other accounts. Eventually, Tilly ordered Christine to exhaustively rewrite a list of phrases meant to jog her memory and persuade her of the consequences of failing to do so. She spent several days rewriting lines such as, "I want to, therefore I can. I know what I must do. Act, otherwise danger. A transmission has taken place within my family. Traces of it remain in my memory. I must, and I can, recover them. This is possible. This transmission represents an astonishing opportunity for us all. It is all very easy. It is within my reach. I must reflect, look myself in the face, have complete confidence in myself, show humility, begin at once. I am capable of this. Concentrate on the desired goal. Do not lie to myself. If I do not do this, I endanger the lives of Guillaume, Omri, and Diane. I will be a bad mother. I must be able to look myself in the face." After months of imprisonment, Christine tried to escape, but she only made it as far as the street before Tilly spotted her on one of his surveillance cameras and brought her back inside by telling her that she was putting her children's lives in danger. In 2007, she was finally let out of the room, but her imprisonment was not over. What she didn't know was that it would resume in the following year, and that her own family members would become her torturers. By January of 2008, Christine was escorted into Tilly's home and was surprised to find that most of her family members, many of whom she hadn't heard from since 2006, were all there waiting for her. After reuniting the family, Tilly sat them down for a lengthy discussion. According to him, one of them knew the location of the transmission, but was hiding it. He told them that until they could find out who it was, they were not permitted to eat, sleep, or leave the room. Moments later, Tilly went downstairs and returned to tell them that he had intercepted an assassin and had successfully neutralized the threat. Tilly claimed that as he went by the kitchen, he bumped into an armed hitman who had broken into the house and was there to slaughter them. Tilly told them that by using his close combat skills, he took out the assassin immediately. His proof of this happening was footprints supposedly left behind during the scuffle. And of course, all of them believed him. Later, Philippe, Ghislaine, Christine, and Charles Henri endlessly interrogated each other in the living room. What followed was a long and illogical discussion, filled with mindless accusations mostly directed at Christine. Sometime prior to this, Tilly told Ghislaine that he had information that Christine had an affair with her father-in-law, and that Christine had seduced him into sharing with her the whereabouts of the transmission. Tilly also said that Guillaume was the incestual love child of Christine and Guillaume's paternal grandfather. Denying this accusation did nothing for Christine. Every member of the 11 believed it. Even Christine's husband, Charles Henri, willingly accepted that Guillaume was not his son simply because Tilly said so. Eventually, they all agreed that it was in fact Christine who had knowledge of the treasure's location. She was then led into the basement where her imprisonment resumed. There, she was ordered to sit on a stool while her family continued to interrogate her. Tilly explained to Charles Henri that because Christine underwent hypnosis years prior, that if she fell asleep during great moments of psychological distress, she would wake up with an insane mind. Despite his medical training, Christine writes that Charles Henri believed Tilly's outrageous claim and became terrified of letting her fall asleep. Thus, whenever she shut her eyes, he'd pinch her earlobes to wake her up. Without access to watches or clocks, they lost track of time. The interrogation continued with no end in sight. Sleep-deprived and hungry, their irritation at Christine mounted as her responses became less and less coherent. Eventually, exhaustion took hold, and Christine made up an account number just to make it all stop. Soon, she was forced to sit on a stool and face the wall. Tilly told her that she was unworthy of looking at the faces of her family members. Occasionally, she fell off the stool and needed to be helped back up. Tilly accused her of doing this on purpose. Then he ordered the others not to let her use the toilet. Later, unable to hold it in any longer, she urinated on herself. In time, Christine started to believe that she may in fact have the secret location of the treasure hidden somewhere inside of her subconscious. She tried her best to remember its location, but had no success in doing so. Later, she strung together a few random digits and names of banks, but when Tilly returned empty-handed, he became even more irate. He then assaulted her, punching her violently on the back while screaming threats and demands into her ear. Everyone watched, but no one intervened. With no results, Tilly reverted back to his favorite method of manipulation, divide and conquer. He accused her of having an affair with Ghislaine's ex-husband, Jean Marchand, and he claimed that he had videos and photos to prove it. Yet again, her family members accepted this unquestioningly, and they didn't even ask to see videos or pictures as proof. In her book, Christine writes, "From the top stair, my three children are watching me, at which point I react furiously and I deny it, the whole thing, protesting loudly that it is ridiculous and completely false. Ghislaine slaps me in the face, bellowing, 'Confess, just confess, he's got a video.' Eventually, exhaustion took hold of all of them. Charles Henry fell asleep while standing against a wall, and Philippe was too starved to continue. After 24 days of torture, the Inquisition of Christine finally came to a close. Then Tilly informed them that due to their failure to locate the hidden treasure, they would have to sell their beloved and ancient property, Chateau Martel. According to him, this was the only way that they would be able to continue to pay him for their protection. Somehow, this brought them momentarily back to their senses. For the first time in several years, they refused to follow his orders and sell Martel. However, their rebellion was short-lived. Tilly persuaded them that they could instead take out a mortgage on Martel, which they could pay back over the course of a few years. Later, they saw a notary agent who refused to aid them in the sale after receiving an anonymous tip that the family were the victims of mental manipulation. At which point, Guillaume called Tilly, who pretended to be his father on the phone while arguing with the notary agent for 3 hours. Eventually, Chateau Martel was sold for 460,000 euros, with the stipulation being that they could purchase the property back by paying a sum of 51,000 euros annually. As Ghislaine recalls in her book, "That day in January 2008, we lost the family property. The money gained from the sale of Chateau Martel was, of course, pocketed by Tilly, who had no intention of paying the annual fee." Soon, the hold Tilly had over the family started to crack, and Philippe became the first member of the 11 to leave. One day in February of 2008, Tilly sat the family down to discuss the details of how he budgeted their money to pay his teams. Then suddenly, Philippe snapped and called him a crook. Tilly sat stunned momentarily before Ghislaine and Charles Henry quickly came to his defense. Ghislaine shouted, "You're losing your mind, Philippe." Charles Henry demanded that he explain himself. Then Tilly suddenly shouted, "He's got a knife in his pocket." Although Philippe showed them that there was nothing but lint in his pocket, the damage was done. Tilly had managed to regain control of the situation and make the others think that their brother Philippe had a knife even though he didn't. Philippe yelled, "You're all blind. Blind, blind, blind." Ghislaine's son, Francois, then ran down the stairs and attacked Philippe. Philippe punched him in the face with enough force to knock him backwards. Then Philippe bolted at Diane, threw himself onto her, and viciously bit her arm. Tilly reappeared in the midst of the chaos and yelled, "What's going on here? Do you realize the spectacle that you're offering here? If you don't immediately cease this brawl, it'll go real bad for all of you, I promise. Do you seriously think I will continue to mobilize my teams to protect a bunch of mentally ill people that beat each other as if they were in a schoolyard? Cease this circus immediately, or I'll give the order to lift the protection around the home. The neighborhood is filled with killers. You would be left at best with 24 hours to live. Am I understood?" After things cooled down, Philippe walked up the stairs and away from the rest of the family. Charles Henry gave first aid to Diane, whose arm was bleeding from her uncle Philippe's bite. Charles Henry attended to Francois as well, who was fine. Christine stood motionless, with a dazed look on her face. On the 5th of February, Philippe, Bridget, and Ghislaine returned to Montflancan by plane. At his house, Philippe noticed that two plates were missing from the cabinet and asked Ghislaine if she took them. She denied that she did, and Bridget tried to take the blame instead, but he didn't believe either of them. Then they sat to have breakfast. Immediately after breakfast was over, Philippe entered Ghislaine's room while she was trying to take a nap. Philippe locked the door behind him. He told her to call Tilly immediately and ask for 50,000 euros while saying, "He's ruining us, and you see nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing." Then he attacked Ghislaine with an avalanche of blows. Her face and mouth quickly became covered with blood. Philippe seized the belt of her bathrobe and proceeded to strangle her with it. Ghislaine managed to liberate herself, but then Philippe started to smother her with a pillow. She nearly died before he realized what he was doing and managed to stop himself. Immediately after that, he called the police. When the police arrived, Philippe was taken to a psychiatric hospital, where he stayed for 2 weeks. His condition, as well as the 7 years under Tilly's control, made a hospital stay necessary. Ghislaine refused to press charges against him, which Tilly later scolded her for. On the 6th of February, 2008, Philippe's daughter called Jean Marchand and told him what had happened. For several years, Philippe's children had distanced themselves from the family. When they first met Tilly in the year 2000, they found him to be ridiculous. They didn't believe that a secret agent with a law degree would be fixing computers at Ghislaine's school. They even investigated Tilly and found out that he had a criminal record. When they tried to tell their father Philippe, he laughed it off and explained that the charges were fabricated and just a part of Tilly's cover. By the time Philippe's daughter called Jean Marchand, any progress in the case had stagnated. There was a financial investigation into Tilly's money laundering which spoke lengths, but nothing came from it. When put into contact with the magistrate, his attempts to pick up the pace came with no success. Moreover, the first wave of articles and television specials about the family had passed. With no new updates in years, the media's interest had died down. A judge had taken an interest in the case, but it was not his highest priority. Additionally, Jean Marchand met with a lawyer named Daniel Picotin, who specialized in fighting against cults, but in order to take any action against Tilly, the authorities needed at least one of the 11 to testify against him. Philippe breaking free of Tilly's hold was a thrilling moment, as it was the lucky break that the case needed. Philippe was a direct victim, making him a potential catalyst for legal action against Tilly. A few days later, Philippe called Jean, and they met in Paris for breakfast at the National Assembly, a parliament building where Jean was working at. When Jean Marchand saw Philippe for the first time in 7 years, he writes that any ill will he felt towards him had suddenly dissipated. Philippe, he said, walked in with an uncertain gait and had a lost look in his eyes. He was no longer with Bridget, who had moved closer to her ex-husband and her children after being emancipated from Tilly's cult. Jean Marchand and Philippe spent the following week together. After years of seclusion, Philippe had a difficult time adjusting to the outside world. Jean Marchand writes that when they went shopping together, quote, Philippe looks at the shelves as if he can't see them. Although Philippe ensured Jean that he was ready to tell him the whole story, and even said that he would sign anything that Jean presented him with, he didn't take any immediate action. Philippe instead procrastinated, lacking the strength and urgency to file a complaint or civil action. Whenever Jean Marchand pressed him to do so, Philippe argued that the others, still under Tilly's control, did not understand anything and that trying to help them would be a waste of time. After much pressure from Jean and his children, Philippe finally took legal action against Tilly. Jean Marchand writes, "One day he called me and said almost triumphantly, 'That's it, I did it.' However, there was still a lot to be done before they could save the rest of the family, and before Thierry Tilly could be finally brought to justice. But there was one other major breakthrough. After reporting Tilly to the police, Philippe gave Jean Marchand a crucial piece of information. It was the address to the house that his wife and children were staying at in England. Immediately after that, Jean traveled to England, hoping that with Philippe's emancipation, this sordid tale would soon come to an end. That's all you-